Right across Australia, this is Sunrise on 7. Now, live from Brekkie Central, Nat and Sherpa.
Hello, welcome to Monday morning on Sunrise, everyone. We have a lot to get through, including we reveal the best frozen chips from the supermarket.
Oh, yes.
I knew you'd like this one. There are 34 brands. We will tell you which ones came out on top, Sherv.
Narrow it down, please. Plus, tax time crackdown. The dodgy claims the ATO is targeting this year. Yep, they do it every year, don't they? How to get your return right and maximise your cash back.
But first to breaking news, police in Mexico have released new details about the case involving the two Australian brothers feared murdered on a surfing trip. Live to US correspondent Miley Hogan, who's in Ensenada. Miley, authorities have just confirmed new details at this hour.
Yeah, now Mexican authorities have revealed the cause of death of those three bodies that were found at the bottom of the well, saying that each died by a single gunshot wound to the head. Three people remain in custody. One has been charged with a crime equivalent to kidnapping. He is known as El Flaco or El Cacas. His real name, José Escorado García Cota. Authorities expect to upgrade charges against him. The other two that are in custody are his brother and his partner. At this stage, those two people are only being held on drug charges as investigators work to determine their level of involvement in this crime. The Attorney General, in the press conference just a few minutes ago, says that investigators still believe that this was an attempted robbery that turned violent, saying that the suspects targeted those three men for their car. But a number of local reporters in that press conference were asking a lot of questions about the fourth body that was also discovered in that well. I can tell you this case here in Mexico has really gained a lot of attention. I want to show you what's happening behind me right now. This is the local Baja surfing community. They have gathered here to show their support for these three Australians. They are angry about this case. They're saying that they want their beaches to be safe and that they want justice for those two Australian brothers and their American.
Okay, thank you very much, Miley. We'll cross back to you soon. Here's Sherbo.
Thanks, Nat. In breaking news, there have been several suspicious fires across Sydney's southwest overnight. When one of the blazes broke out, an elderly woman had to evacuate her home. Let's go live to Liam Tapper at St Helens Park. Liam, what do police know so far?
Good morning, Sherbo. Well, they are investigating a number of suspicious fires across southwest Sydney, which all took place in the matter of an hour or so here at St Helens Park. If you can take a look at that, you can see that a car has been driven in through the front of a garage and that home has been completely destroyed. Now, inside that home, there was an elderly woman who had to be pulled out by a resident here who live in this street. Now, she fortunately is okay, but her home has been destroyed. Now, police, they will be investigating this as very suspicious because just Wednesday last week, another house very close by to this one in this same street, it was shot at a number of times in a drive-by shooting. So police are investigating whether this may have been a case of mistaken identity. Now, there were a number of other cars burnt out across southwest Sydney in Ayres and in Claymore. Police say it's too early on in the investigation to determine whether these were used as a getaway vehicle maybe for this potentially targeted attack here in St Helens Park, but Sherbo, certainly terrifying for these residents, but also that woman who was inside who fortunately escaped death early this morning.
Okay, Liam, thanks for popping up the link and giving us a little bit more information on that more throughout the morning.
How frightening, wasn't it? Let's get more news. Here's Eddie.
Thank you, Nat. We're learning new details this morning about the fatal police shooting of a radicalised teenager in Perth. Let's go live to 7 News reporter Tina Altieri for us. Tina, crisis talks have been held in WA overnight over this.
That's right, Eddie, and they've stopped short of calling this a terrorist attack, but they're expected to after taking a look at more evidence overnight. Here's what we know, that the 16-year-old made a chilling call to police threatening to commit acts of violence. It's now been revealed in a message to friends on social media. He asks for forgiveness for being wronged, and he goes on to say that I'm going on the path of jihad and I take responsibility for the actions that will take place tonight. Then Then, within minutes in the Bunnings car park in Willerton, he lunges at police. They taser him twice, but the teenager continues to advance on the third officer, who fires a fatal single shot. It was only after backup arrived that police found the boy's victim, a man in his 30s, who had been stabbed in the back a short time earlier. He's now in a stable condition in hospital this morning. Dozens of frantic calls to police from the Muslim community too. Investigators saying that that rapid response helped stop terror in its tracks. A crisis meeting of interfaith leaders was called, where it was revealed the 16-year-old had been on a police watch list. Let's take a listen.
We not only condemn this in the harshest terms possible, but we would also like to mention that Islam has nothing to do with any acts of violence that are committed in its name.
The troubled Caucasian boy, we know for a fact, had been in a de-radicalisation program, Eddie, one that now has the community and police asking how this teenager, who indeed was in their grasp, slipped through.
Tina Altieri there, live in Perth. Thank you. Four boys have been suspended from their elite Melbourne private school over a sexism scandal. Let's go live to Sarah Jane Bell at the Yarra Valley Grammar School this morning. Sarah Jane, what are they accused of doing?
Well, Eddie, the four Year 11 students here at the prestigious Yarra Valley Grammar School are accused of creating a highly offensive spreadsheet that contained photos of girls in their grade and then ranked them in order from wifeys and cuties through to get out and even, most shockingly, unrapeable. Now, the girls involved in that spreadsheet, the ones that had been ranked, they are now receiving counselling. As you say, the four boys that are believed to have created that table, well, they have been suspended. The principal here, Dr. Mark Berry, labelling their actions disgraceful. He says we need to get to the bottom of this and work out who is responsible and hold them accountable. We're still trying to work out who did the posting and then working out about the bystanders. Now, of course, these students' actions come at a time when the nation is focused on stamping out violence against women and sexism. Now, this matter will also be referred to police to find out whether the term unrapeable constitutes a threat. Eddie?
Thank you, Sarah Jane. To Sunrise weather alert now, and rolling showers along the east coast could get worse before they get better, unfortunately. Sydney is predicted to receive its entire May rainfall average within the next few days, and up to 150 millimetres over the course of the week. There were six flood rescues overnight, and SES crews have been called to reports of trees down and roofs leaking. A severe weather warning for parts of the central coast and south coast has, however, been cancelled this morning. Coastal parts of Queensland are also set for soaking. A grandmother is recovering in hospital this morning after she was struck by an e-scooter rider outside the MCG following the Collingwood-Carlton blockbuster over the weekend. Let's go live to Sunrise Melbourne correspondent Andrew McCormack. Andrew, morning to you. This was such a callous attack.
Well, 80-year-old Jessie Hatch, Eddie, was making her way home from the MCG when she says she was intentionally knocked down by an e-scooter rider. She was walking from the MCG here up towards Jollymont Station on Friday night. She confronted the rider who was on the middle of the footpath to ask him to step aside to let her walk past. She walked about 5 to 10 metres beyond him. That's when she says she was knocked down in front of a number of witnesses. Now, she was taken to hospital. She's been there all weekend suffering a number of cuts and bruises. She's in a stable condition, has 5 stitches put into one of her hands.
We're waiting for an MRI scan to see if there's any permanent damage to her spine. It's pretty scary.
From the beginning, why would somebody do that?
So she's calling for the alleged offender to come forward. A number of witnesses actually gave chase as he fled the scene. Police are investigating, Eddie.
Thank you so much, Andrew. Queensland is introducing paid reproductive health leave for public servants in what's believed to be an Australian first. Let's go live to Georgia Costi in Brisbane. Georgia, this is an interesting move. The Sunshine State leading the way here.
That's right, Eddie. This is a huge win for public servants, and it will make Queensland the first state to offer reproductive health leave. What this means is that these workers will get 10 days off paid to go and do things like IVF treatments or treatments for other chronic conditions like breast cancer or prostate cancer. On top of that, the government will also soon introduce superannuation payments for parents who are on unpaid leave. They say that in particular, the idea here is to bridge the gap between men and women, because as we know, women women often retire with a lot less savings than men. Now, both of these policies are something that Queensland's powerful unions have been pushing for, and Eddie, both of them are set to cost around $103 million every year.
Thank you, Georgia. There was a record turnout at Coolangatta over the weekend for the Out to Lunch Festival. 30,000 people hitting the beach for a night of music and fun. Let's go live to Tamara Bowe, who's frankly still recovering from the weekend. Tamara, the event was so successful. There are calls for more just like it.
Eddie, we have never seen anything quite like this, and we managed to pull it off right here in the tiny town of Coolangatta on the southern end of the Gold Coast. Saturday night, record crowds, 30,000 people kicked off their shoes, headed for the beach and transformed Coolangatta into Australia's biggest ever beach party for the Out to Lunch Festival. It has been deemed a phenomenal success. Accommodation providers were booked out as people came from interstate to see headline act DJ Fisher at his very own festival, and our cafes, restaurants, bars were also packed to the rafters as well, so a huge coup for the southern end. No real complaints when it came to transport, getting people in and out, and emergency services and police were also pretty happy with crowd behaviour. Such a success, Eddie, that now organisers are eyeing off bringing another big event here to Coolangatta, transforming the Gold Coast into the beach party capital of Australia.
Looked absolutely epic. Thank you, Tamara.